We're in the heart of trachoma, the world's leading cause of preventable blindness.
The kids are the reservoir of infection of trachoma. And the flies that are attracted to the kids' faces go straight to the mothers.
She's blind in this eye. This is a disease of old people in other countries. But in Ethiopia, there are kids as young as 10 or 11 who've already had the whole process.
What I've seen, you know, is the impact of health education.
When the community is committed, anything is possible.
What we are doing is having the audacity to challenge Mother Nature to try and kick trachoma out of here.
Funding for this program is provided by the John Moores Family.
I love being on a drive in a rural part of Ethiopia. You have a destination in mind, and you take a turn, but it opens into a new vista, the one that you didn't expect. And you take the next turn, and it's urban. The next turn, and it's a green space opens up, and a terraced fields. You just never know what's around the next turn. Wow.
On the Horn of Africa, Ethiopia is the continent's second most populous nation. Nearly 100 million people, some of the world's poorest, most of them living in rural areas like the mountainous region of Amhara.
Today is Saturday and we are driving to a market place.
This community is the major market town for the whole area. Yes. And probably 20, 30 communities live around this market town.
Yes.
So they're all having to walk 2, maybe 3 hours to come to the market.
She's beautiful.
Kelly Callahan heads the Trachoma Control Program for the Carter Center, based in Atlanta.
Million people live in Amhara, and a quarter of the population is susceptible to this blinding disease caused by a bacterial infection called chlamydia trachomatis. Trachoma is the leading cause of preventable blindness in the world, and this is the heart of it. It is transmitted through a fly. This fly breeds on human feces. What happens is someone that has chlamydia, trachomatis, has discharge out of their eyes and their nose. So this eye-seeking fly lands on this discharge and then takes that on its feet to the next person. And then the next person, and then the next person. And each person that has this bacterial infection, chlamydia, transmits from their discharge, their eyes and their nose, through this fly in a densely populated area that can happen very quickly. And what happens is, if my body's a barometer of chlamydia trachomatis, when I get to about here, my eyelid starts to turn in, my eyelashes start to scrape my eye. So my eyelashes start to scrape my cornea. And when that starts to happen, it's painful. So I want to pull my eyelashes out.
Hey, it's Aguru. Yasnakalalundi. Warantalot? Oh. This is our local remedies. It's an epilation tool.
The misdirection of eyelashes toward the eye is called trachiasis. These eyelashes scrape the cornea and cause pain with each blink. To relieve the pain, victims usually treat themselves by epilating their eyelashes, pulling them out with tweezers. When new eyelashes start growing, they scrape the cornea of the eye again, causing scarring and eventual blindness. Before living standards improved, trachoma was a common disease worldwide, including Europe. At Ellis Island in New York, European immigrants were routinely checked for trachoma.
So the officials at Ellis Island would take a little steel pick and pick up every potential immigrant's eyelids to see if they were infected. If they had trachoma, then they were either put in quarantine if it was not a very serious case, or if it was serious, they would send them back home to Europe or wherever they came from.
As a child raised in the American South, President Jimmy Carter recalls seeing neighbors who suffered from blinding trachoma.
Trachoma was not a well-known disease in some places, but in South Georgia, where we had a lot of animal excrement and human excrement on the ground and houseflies bred, then it was a serious problem for all of us.
Today, trachoma is still the leading infectious cause of blindness. It is believed to be an epidemic in more than 50 countries, with about 44 million people suffering from active infection. Some 230 million are at risk.
And the disease affects twice as many women as men because women are more involved in the care of young children. It's a big problem.
And nowhere is the disease more prevalent than here, in Amhara.
So this patient has got white cornea peripherally and redness around the cornea.
If treated in time, damage to the cornea can be stopped.
When the ulcer heals, your vision will improve.
But in most cases, scarring of the cornea cannot be healed, and loss of vision cannot be reversed.
He has itching sensation, but didn't remove eyelash from his eyelid. And as you can see, it is red. She has got trachoma in the left eye, but not in the right eye. Yeah, she epilated the day before. She has this problem for the last 7 years. It has got the needle-like pricking pain. Yeah, because of the pain, because of the pricking, the leg pain, she usually does not work properly.
So this can affect children all the way up through elderly.
It can affect anyone, but importantly, it affects women and children.
Okay.
Women.
In Ethiopia, my counterpart is Dr. Zerahun Tedese, who is the country representative for the Carter Center.
Women, because as they care for their children, they may use their shawl to clean the face of the children, one child.
So the bacteria can be transmitted through a towel?
A towel.
Wiping their face with the towel?
Exactly.
And then wiping their own face.
So by using that material, they transmit the disease from one child to another, and even to herself.
Fatima Nuru lives with her son, Hussein, and his wife and their 4 children. She is responsible for the household, and she suffers from trachoma.
Trachoma really is a household disease. It circulates at home between family members. And it moves on people's hands when they rub their eyes, touch somebody else, and the second person then rubs their own eyes. It moves on bed sheets when you share a bed. It moves on the cloth wraps that women have wrapped around their bodies. These are the typical vectors. In addition to that, a fly called Musca sorbens feeds aggressively on the corners of children's eyes, particularly if they have any discharge. They then move from the infected child to the uninfected child.
They saw that I have hair rubbing on my eye. I need to pull my eyelashes out every 2 weeks to relieve the pain.
I usually work in the early morning, well into the evening here in the field. I do this work with pleasure, because this is our livelihood.
Aragao Walde is building his home on his parents' land, and he plans to be married soon.
I was feeling a foreign object inside my eye, a sharp object rubbing against my eyeball. So I was rubbing it to remove that object.
Trachoma traditionally affects the people at the end of the road. They're the forgotten people. They are people with very little political voice. People with trachoma are not lying on the street in the capital, Addis Ababa, dying. Because trachoma is a hidden disease, it's very difficult for people to care. Well, we do care. And we want to reach all of those people. Here in Amhara, because this is the most affected state in the most affected country, we want this to be the demonstration project. What we're doing here is the single largest control effort for trachoma that the world has ever seen.
We will mobilize, you know, the people.
In a region with few radios or televisions, a public information campaign like this is the only effective way to spread the word about controlling trachoma.
We'll surround, you know, all the town. We have seen, you know, the impact of health education. Most of the time, really, if you put, you know, something, you know, in the children's mind, they will take home and they will discuss with their own family. If you disseminate information without sugar, really, it's sore.
The campaign also educates people about other health issues.
In our program, we'll mix, you know, some sugar inside to make it sweet, the program.
The World Health Organization has approved a global strategy to control trachoma, a strategy based on the four letters that spell the word SAFE.
The SAFE strategy is a strategy that's built on four pillars: surgery, antibiotic, face washing, and environmental improvement. The antibiotic, the A component of the SAFE strategy, is required to control the bacteria, to keep the bacterial at a level that will not allow that person to suffer the consequences of blinding trachoma. The antibiotic used is azithromycin. Its name is Zithromax. A lot of people know it by Z-Pak in the developed world. It is distributed by an army of people in each of the countries where we work.
Let it be. Since 1998, about 500 million doses of the antibiotic Zithromax have been donated to trachoma endemic countries by the Pfizer pharmaceutical company.
Twice a year, the Health Development Army, the health education workers, the Ministry of Health, the Carter Center, the Lions Club come together and they carry out full-scale, large-scale drug distribution. Over 6 million people are treated during 1 week. This is intense logistics, intense supply chain. This is the program coming to where the disease is, bringing all of the people to one location and delivering drug right to them at that location in a very large scale. This is outreach.
Let's make an announcement now about Monday. Let's go into the center. All patients who had treatment with the Ferengi 1 year ago for their eyes, for their trachoma, you have your follow-up appointment on Monday morning. Monday morning, please come for your follow-up appointment.
In his research trials, Dr. Saul Rajak has studied thousands of trachoma patients in Ethiopia.
Good, well, that's one of our patients, so another 99 to find. We conducted trachoma campaigns a year ago in this area, and we've got about 100 or so patients in this area that we needed to find to do a checkup a year later, see how their eyes are doing, see whether they need any further treatment.
We're investigating ways to improve the treatment of trachoma to trachiasis, to work out who really urgently needs treatment and who can wait with epilation.
She's blind in this eye.
Trachiasis is the late stage where the eyelashes have already turned inwards and are scratching on the surface of the eye and therefore causing the blindness.
Let's start taking patients off straight away and get going because we've got quite a lot of people to see. Most of them are here. This is Tirafat, who is the first stage of our conveyor belt. She does the questionnaire to assess whether they're happy, whether they have any pain, whether they've started epilating eyelashes. So this is the next stage of the conveyor belt. This is a visual acuity testing. We use an e-chart rather than letters, as obvious reasons. 93% of our patients are illiterate. So Taraku takes photographs of all of our patients, so we take macro photographs of their eyes, and with the photographs we can assess whether there's been any change, whether there's been an improvement, and it's a good record to go back to in case there's any doubt about any of our patients. One of the things we don't understand about trachoma is you get the infection as a child, and yet 30 years later you still have an inflamed, angry eyelid that is still causing problems and is still turning inwards. And those patients seem to be doing fine in every other way, they're healthy, and yet this process that has been initiated as a child is still going 30 years later. Yeah, that's a flipped eyelid, which is a very easy thing to do, it's what children do in playgrounds. And what you can see is it's actually quite red. And this is a lady whose infection was probably 40 or 50 years ago, and yet the eyelid is still red. So there's still an inflammatory active process going on in there. We've given her a pair of these forceps, we've asked her to epilate the one or two eyelashes that come. We don't particularly want to operate on her because she has such a minor degree of the disease. Buongiorno. I epilated one eyelash from the right cornea.
She doesn't know her age, but we're thinking probably 18 or 20, which just gives some idea of how severe the disease is in Ethiopia, because this is a disease of old people in other trachoma endemic countries. But in Ethiopia, there are kids as young as 10 or 11 who've already had the whole process from the infection at the beginning to the scarring, to the interning of the eyelashes, to the lashes scratching the cornea. In other countries, that's a 40 or 50 year process.
Lateral zero, corneal zero, T2.
She's already got corneal scarring from her disease. She's really lucky because her corneal scarring's not in the center and her surgery's done before the damage has actually got too far. So she had surgery of both eyes a year ago. It's been pretty successful. The corneal scarring should stop now that the eyelashes aren't scratching anymore, but it was relatively in the nick of time. There's an enormous amount of people who need trachoma surgery in this country.
Currently, she's injecting local anesthesia. Now we are seeing the three cases surgery. This surgery is called TPR, tarsal plate rotation.
In the quick and simple surgery for trochiasis, the edge of the eyelid is rotated outward, away from the eyeball, so that the lashes are no longer in contact with the eye. The inverted lid is then released from the main lid and sutured back, so that the lashes no longer rub against the cornea.
She was trained last year, and through this 12 months, she performed 300 trochiasis surgeries. And she's very happy. She said, my power is my eye. It is a minor surgery. That is why the surgery is done not necessarily by surgeons. It can be done by nurses or trained medical personnel. So it is a minor surgery.
It is collaborative. Their Lions Club, the Carter Center, community-based health workers have made enormous progress in the SNA components of the SAFE strategy. Surgery and antibiotics, it's a deliverable. We can hand someone Zithromax. We can count the number of people that have had trochiasis surgery. But the F and the E component, the face washing and the environmental improvement, those are much harder. The challenge that lies ahead is to focus on a strategy with face washing and environmental improvement to change people's behavior. The hardest thing in public health is to change people's behavior.
The bacteria can't move by itself from person to person. It moves on people's hands when they rub their eyes, shake hands with somebody else, or touch somebody else. And the second person then rubs their own eyes.
They are telling me about 200 people are making use of this water source.
If there isn't sufficient water to drink, there's not enough water to wash with. And that is one of the big infrastructural barriers that we face in Amhara Regional State, is access to water. One of the very important messages that we try to convey, particularly through schools, is that you don't need a large amount of water to wash your face. A very small amount, literally a cup, is sufficient to maintain facial cleanliness. They wash their faces every morning and every evening. And when they come to school, they look at themselves in the mirror in the classroom. And if they're dirty again, they wash it. Where the program works well in schools, the children form trachoma clubs. Those kids take responsibility for clean face promotion in the schools. And in some places, kids are actually awarded a medal or a badge for clean face of the week. Children in primary schools, young as they are, can be agents of change in the community. They can also be little health workers.
The continuous condition of the disease makes the eye lines curved inward. To control the disease, what we call trachoma, quickly, it is necessary to use the following four main methods. These are known as SAFE.
And one of the aims of the school-based program is a homework assignment where the children are supposed to ask their family about people with trachiasis. Have you heard anything from your school children about the trachoma program?
Yeah,
what he said is every morning you should wash your hands and then face with soap and water.
Right.
And this helps you to protect from trachoma.
Excellent. That's exactly what I was hoping I would hear. Are your eyes giving you any problem?
I know tenia motalloy hakim no yai. Yes, so that's not clear.
Can you ask if she's aware that there is a treatment for this condition?
Hakimna ndallo yakallo yai.
Sochu taragwai challo hun yemechem gun almokorku.
She just heard there are people who are treated. I heard from people, but right. I didn't try it yet.
Right. It might be a good idea for her to investigate further before her vision is impaired. It could be saved.
Yes.
Thank you for letting us in. The incredible thing is that we clearly could not have prepared these people for our visit. And we go into the house and we see that the health education messages have reached the target audience. And we come out and just walking past is a woman with trachiasis. And then whilst we were counseling her, another lady who was post-operative had walked past. And it's incredible that wherever we go, trachoma is everywhere in this vicinity. Can't get away from trachoma. Can you ask, has anybody heard of distribution this year?
No, they said we didn't.
I've
asked them. Medhani ti set al tabulo sinagare sammaso allo e kanantost. Sammaso ille. Sammaso ille. Nobody heard about it. No announcement.
So trachoma is certainly known here.
Yes, it is.
And the program is known.
Yeah.
And there's been work in the school, but for some reason, the this round of distribution hasn't made it up here yet.
Yeah.
Rainwashed gullies like these are very popular places for open defecation. You can hide yourself there. Human feces that is lying on the surface of the ground provides the single best breeding medium for this fly that transmits trachoma. If we can get the human feces off the ground and into a pit latrine, it reduces the population of Muscosorbens flies. Because Muscosorbens flies transmit trachoma and because they breed in human feces, promotion of sanitation and the safe disposal of human feces is one of the core elements of trachoma control programs. This is a latrine that's been built and the superstructure has collapsed. And rather than repair it, they've just gone back to using the bush. There's a hand washing station here, which is dry and full of oil palm nuts, so that's clearly not in use either. So plenty to go here. Things have started but not finished. It looks like the people have reverted to open defecation. So there are always what we call the laggards in the community, people who will not adopt a new technology. And no matter how much discussion you have with them, they are reluctant to leave the traditional ways. Those are always the very last people to come on board. They probably form maybe as high as 1 in 5 families who want to see for themselves that putting effort into change is going to yield some sort of benefit.
This is a very provocative statement here. It says a human being should not be less than a cat. Because a cat defecates and buries its own feces. But human beings should not be any less.
So even in a country like Ethiopia, where it is socioeconomically very poor, highly populated. This disease is the poorest of the poor.
This disease, unfortunately, is affecting the most disadvantaged, who live far away from the end of the road, who have inadequate access to basic health services. So it is like adding burden to an already burdened community living far away.
The Carter Center is different. We're assisting the Ministry of Health in the farthest location. We're going where the disease is.
We entirely rely on the structure that is created by the government, like the Health Development Army. Hundreds of thousands of women are on day-to-day basis assisting their neighbors. Thousands of health extension workers are working day to day to make sure that the community members lead a healthy and promising life.
Our economy depends on land and labor. And it's not a capital-intensive economy. We depend on healthy labor and arable land. You know, the social system in this country is such that when somebody is sick, the neighbors call each other and carry this man to the nearby health facility. They spend their half a week to get him treated. And in the process, they spend a lot of time that could have been spent on farmland. So we need trachoma eliminated from this region. It's a way of fighting poverty.
Yeshereg Kinfe is one of thousands of health extension workers employed in rural areas by Ethiopia's government.
I have been serving this village for 7 years. Before I arrived, the community did not know about the importance of latrines and sanitation. After I started working with them on personal and environmental hygiene, the community has been showing a great improvement. Everybody has a latrine now.
Yeshereg has been following Fatima's case, advising her on treatment.
Fatima was convinced to get surgery after seeing a neighbor go through the procedure with an improvement in her vision. But she didn't have surgery until now because of fear. She expected she might completely lose her eye. Mother, are you now ready for the surgery?
The timing is not good because of farming work, but yes, I will do it.
One of the challenges that we've had in Ethiopia and in other countries is refusal of surgeries. People are offered surgery, and instead, they're choosing to use tweezers to continue to pull out their eyelashes.
It took them a long time to make that decision, because they think that once they are operated, they will not be back to their normal household chores for quite long, when that is not the case.
Aragao has been told by his health extension worker that he needs surgery to avoid losing his sight. Elsa Abate oversees healthcare for hundreds of families in her territory.
Arago's problem is more commonly found in older patients. Trichiasis can develop in a very short period of time. So from his childhood, in my opinion, he may not have had very good personal hygiene.
I'm preparing this latrine for my new home. I'm digging the hole 3 meters deep.
I'm just happy that we identified this problem before there was any visual impairment.
Of course, the problem is serious for me. It requires immediate surgery, I understand. But because I'm a farmer and it's summer, is it possible to postpone the surgery for 2 to 3 weeks?
This fly that transmits trachoma does not like latrines. There are too many competitors for this fly inside of a latrine for the eggs and the larvae. It cannot survive inside of a latrine. So if we can get the population to change their behavior, start using latrines for defecation, we can reduce the fly population incredibly, thus reducing the transmission of trachoma precipitously. The hills and the distances where the communities live from one to another are very far. The roads are challenging. And walking 2 to 3 hours, it takes a lot of time and energy and effort. So they would want to relieve themselves along the way.
Yes.
Having a latrine where you can privately relieve yourself when there's a lot of people moving along the roads is very important to someone, especially a woman who is leaving her village, her community, and going to another community. She would want to look for privacy. So this is a community latrine built by this community just off the side of the road, so that when people come to the market, they have a place to defecate.
And if this is not done, it is the host community which is going to suffer from the after effects of open defecation.
So this is the health extension worker,
yes,
that is helping this community,
yes,
build a community latrine. Yeah. This is the 11th community latrine in this Kebele.
There are 750 households in the Kebele.
Uh-huh.
Each and every household has their own private latrine.
This is all a community effort.
When the community is committed, anything is possible.
So this is a really nice construction of completely indigenous materials.
Everything you see here is collected from the nearby village.
They purchase nothing?
Nothing.
So they're using their time,
yes,
their energy, and resources that are easily available.
I'm going in.
Good luck.
So this can come down, and I will be completely private. All these bags that make up the wall are from their own sacks. And every piece of wood in here, every stick has come from the community. So this is really nice.
Hello.
It's a nice latrine. I don't see flies on the children's faces. I don't see flies on the adults' faces. See, look at how beautiful her face is. Her eyes, so clear, nothing, no trachiasis, beautiful. You know, in my culture, they say the eyes are the window to the soul.
Women and girls culturally are not supposed to be seen openly defecating or urinating during the day. So they would either have to find a place to hide or they would have to hold themselves until dark so no one would see them urinating or defecating. This ability to go to the bathroom when they need to has certainly liberated so many women and girls.
Now the latrine revolution came. Women are now exercising their freedom. This is really like being born again. they call it. It's just like being born again. We are now in a new world, in a new civilization, because of just these latrines. We are really changing the cultures, the bad traditions in hygiene and sanitation.
Nice and clean. Sometimes it's hard for me. I get emotional immediately when I see a child that has flies in its eyes and nose. You have trachoma. When I see a woman that is going blind because of eyelashes scraping her cornea.
Tell her to go to hospital.
This woman's name is Abane, and she's at the end game. Nothing can be done at this stage. She can't have surgery. Nothing can fix it. So she will live the rest of her years completely blind from this disease.
What we find with trachiasis is not just a cause of blindness. It's a cause of stigma, low self-esteem, inability to work.
She's probably a candidate for surgery at some point.
Get easy.
Do the eyelashes and regular operation, does it affect her ability to work or to do normal daily things or to cook?
He's saying, you know, there is even a conflict between us, he's saying.
She automatically, you know, sleep, you know, in the house. Okay. That's why, you know, he's very much, you know, angry because, you know, if you don't help me, really, why you are living, you know, with me, he said. It's very difficult, yeah, because, you know, we have many children, right. And without help, really, we can't, you know, continue our life, you know, like this way.
The horror of trachoma and the misery of trachoma goes way beyond blindness.
Zerahun, there's a woman over here that has had TT surgery.
Wa alaykum assalam.
Assalamu alaikum.
I feel immediately compelled, charged, and excited to help these people make changes.
He's saying that after the treatment, I'm quite healthy, I can take care of myself, and I'm leading a very happy life.
Alhamdulillah. I get excited to help people prevent diseases.
This is why we do what we do. This is the safe strategy in action. Surgery to take care of everyone that has had trachiasis. Antibiotics to reduce the disease burden. Very simple technology. This is the end of a Bic pen. Face washing so the fly has nothing to feed on the eyes and the nose. This says latrine and shower. And latrines so the fly has no place to breathe.
This is very practical demonstration of how it is possible to get rid of fly population and by doing that, rid of trachoma.
Bilal also has clean face.
What gives me satisfaction in working in public health in general and trachoma program in particular is it is a disease that primarily affects women and children who are the future of this country. And that is impossible if we fail to do something significant to alleviate the problem.
I've not been in a marketplace before.
Yeah.
Where every single child.
Yeah.
That I've seen has a clean face.
Iman. Iman. This is Iman. She also has very clean face and she's beautiful.
Seriously.
She's beautiful.
I gotta tell you, Zerahun, I'm really surprised. There's so few flies here.
Yes, so few flies. While standing in the middle of a big market.
I am belonging to a group which is making history in Ethiopia.
Thank you.
ተጠጋ በትራኮማ በሽታ ምክንያት የአይን ጥራ አይናችሁን እየወጋ ለሚያስቸግራችሁና ወረቶ ለምታስነክሩና በዛሬ ዕለት በረሳ ጤና ጣቢያ የነጻ ሕክምና ስለሚሰጥ በጤና ጣቢያ ብረት በመገኘት በመገኘት በነጻ እንድትታከሙ እናሳስባለን።
አለክ ነው ይሄ ለታመመ ሰው መናገሩና መወያቱ ጥሩ ነው። አሁን ስንት ቦታ የተየ ስንት ገንዘብ የቀለጠን ትሪያ ነው እዚህ ወደ ጃፋች እንዴት ያለ ተሆነ
ሀዘኔን በደስታ
I'm happy he will get the surgery.
We make a living from our farmland, so we put a lot of emphasis on the work in the field rather than issues of health and so on. Not many of us seriously follow what education they are giving us.
How old is he?
22.
22, he's very young.
Yeah, young.
If he's blind from trachiasis, can he farm?
On the moment the ballo tarazon masalay. He said no. If I'm blind, then there is no way for me to work in my field.
The surgery will not take long. The surgery will be done in their health center. And within 5 or 6 days, they'll be back to their normal activities.
The trachiasis surgery is such a minimal surgery. The surgeon injects a numbing agent into the eyelid. The eyelid is rotated. The scarring area is cut out, and then the eyelid is stitched back so that the eyelid that has been inverted is now moved in a position that is no longer causing the eyelashes to touch the eyeball. It takes approximately 15 minutes per eyelid to perform the surgery. And a patch is placed on the eye, and the patient feels virtually no pain.
The patient doesn't have to stay here. They can go home very soon after the surgery, within some minutes.
The number of trachiasis surgeries done in Ethiopia is almost 45% of the total trachiasis surgery done in the world. Our goal is to eliminate blinding trachoma from the total geographical area of Ethiopia.
We can always see people who have been operated for trachiasis, but I'm concerned about the people who have not been operated. There are kids with clean faces, and I love to see that, but I'm always concerned about the kids who do not yet have clean faces. People here in Ethiopia are pretty much the same as they are all over the world. We have the same hopes and aspirations, and one of those simple, basic human hopes is that your kids are going to have a better life than you do.
The poorest people on earth who don't even have an outdoor toilet, much less running water to wash their faces, and who are surrounded by human and animal excrement, they suffer from this disease. From a distance, you think the children have eyeglasses on. And when you get close to them, you see that it's a circle of flies constantly around their eyes, getting moisture out of their eyes. And those children don't know about the advantages of cleanliness. And they just accept the fact that house flies are always on their eyes. It's just a matter of life. But the poorest families are the ones that don't ever know, don't ever learn the things that the Carter Center has learned about trachoma. Those are the ones that we try to address most frequently.
The Trachoma campaign is another illustration of the fact that poor people, very poor people, can and will change their behavior so long as they see that it's in their interest to do so. And I think that is extremely hopeful. It's a very big hope for other people and for other countries, because they would not have to work as hard as Ethiopia has had to work to attack and successfully eliminate blinding trachoma.
Since 2001, the partnership between Ethiopia's government, the Carter Center, the Lions Club International Foundation, and local Lions Clubs has promoted the SAFE strategy to control trachoma in the Amhara region. More than 400,000 corrective eyelid surgeries have been performed, some 3 million household latrines constructed, and more than 109 million doses of donated Zithromax have been distributed. All of this supported by sustained health and hygiene education in thousands of communities.
Ethiopia is ever committed to get rid of trachoma. At this point in time, I have the feeling of someone walking up a hilly mountain. With due effort, it is possible, it is practical to reach the top of the mountain.
When I left for Africa in 1996 as a United States Peace Corps volunteer, I wanted to positively affect one person's life.
Through the partnership, collectively, we have improved the lives of millions of people. And that takes my one person on a scale that I could have never, ever, ever dreamed of.
If we can focus on a balanced, safe strategy, we can eliminate blinding trachoma by the year 2020.
Would that so start?
In this trachoma control program, the world's largest, the results can already be seen. Prevalence rates of 60% and higher have declined drastically to about 30% or lower. There is still much work to be done, but for millions here, the curse of blinding trachoma is ending, charting a path for others to follow in Ethiopia beyond this remote region and in other countries where trachoma is still a serious threat.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, Kevin.
Blinding trachoma can be eliminated. This is a disease that people don't need to suffer from this anymore.
I'm happy.
I'm happy.
This is a low-hanging fruit. We just need to get rid of it so people can focus on things that are more important.
To find out more about this and other Global Health Frontiers programs, visit globalhealthfrontiers.org. Funding for this program is provided by the John Moores Family.
Tabi, 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 t